As you might have seen the abstract, what I try to do in the presentation today is to give a certain perspective that perhaps shifts the balance of what is normally thought about Sufism under the Safavid period. We tend to have this image that the Safavids were great Sufi koshis. But I think if you look at the case of what happens in the period of the Safavid period to the Qalandars, we find something very, very interesting happened. Now, I don't know to what extent you have a background in Sufism, and in particular the Qalandars, so some of what I might say could be basic for you, but please bear with me. We'll get to perhaps the meaty substance of the presentation towards the end. Don't have a paper, okay? I tend to find that when I have a paper, people just leave. So the best thing to do is I can keep my eyes on you, so you get really, really embarrassed if you do leave, okay? So I've got a presentation, a PowerPoint presentation, and hopefully we can make it more interesting that way. So my introduction, looking at the Safavid relationship with Sufism, as I've said, the general tendency, especially among Western scholars, is to more or less believe that there was a kind of inherent hostility, if you like, between the Safavids and Sufism. Now, of course, Sufism is a huge social movement. It includes various Sufi orders. It might include people who are perhaps more inclined towards Irfan. And it might include Qalandar Sufis. So it's a huge term that we're dealing with. And so we really need to be quite specific when we think about these terms, what we're actually dealing with. What is interesting with the Qalandars in the context of Safavid Iran is that we find in Persian texts, which were written in about the 15th and 16th century, there seems to have been an inclination of some Qalandar groups towards Shi'a Islam. Okay, now this is quite different when we think about the Sufi orders which existed in Iran at the time. So that, for example, you can think of maybe orders such as the Naqshbandis, the Mevlevis, the Khalvatiyes, all of which were apparently a Sunni order. However, we do need to be careful when we're talking about these denominational distinctions at the time, simply because the vast majority of Sufi orders trace their lineage back through to Imam Ali. Although, of course, for many of these orders, Imam Ali doesn't have the same kind of connotation of an imam as 12 Shi'ism does. Ali was simply a great spiritual hero for many of these Sufi orders. But it's true to say, I think, that from the 12th century onwards, there's an increasing emphasis on the role that Ali played within Sufi orders. Sufi orders, in fact, more or less became a social phenomenon, if you like, a social manifestation in about the 13th and 14th century anyway. Okay, and it's that at that time we really do notice a greater emphasis played upon the role of Ali as a kind of patron saint, if you like. As I've already mentioned, in the course of this paper, I'll be looking specifically at the role that Qalandars played in the Safavid state, or the Safavid framework, or the set up in society, if you like, to argue the case that, as opposed to what happened to the Sufi orders, like the Mevlevis, something very different happened to the Qalandars. Just want to say here, as I go on, if you have a question, I'm quite happy to deal with questions as we go along. Don't save it till right at the end, because it's possible we'll lose track or we'll lose the gist of what I'm saying. So please, if you have a question, just, you know, blurt it out. So, back to very, very simple basics. What is Sufism? Of course, Sufism is a huge phenomenon. As I mentioned, there are various Sufi orders, Irfani Sufis, Sufis who are perhaps more interested in the practical exercises as opposed to the intellectual disciplines that are sometimes associated with Irfani Sufism. We can look at the different forms that Sufism took, and these more or less consolidated, if you like, around about the 12th and 13th century around specific masters, so that we can talk about the Sufism of someone like Ibn Arabi, which perhaps was much, much more intellectualized, okay? As opposed to, let's say, the Sufism of the Mevlevi order, which perhaps was more specific and characterized by specific Sufi practices, such as samar, okay? Such as regarding the self, some kind of introspection, okay? At the same time, we can point to the kind of Sufism of someone like Abu Hafs Umar Sohrawardi, who died in the year 1234. And his kind of Sufism was perhaps much, much more, less ecstatic, if you like, than the Sufism of Maulana or even Ibn Arabi. For someone like Sohrawardi, he's much more interested in, if you like, the transcendence, the tanzi nature of God, rather than the tashbi nature of God. Some people may like to put this these forms of Sufism as diametrically opposed. So to what extent can we talk about practical Sufism as opposed to a kind of Irfani Sufism, which is a kind of like, if you like, an armchair form of Sufism, a theoretical form of Sufism, Irfani Nazari, if you like. Or to what extent is this bifurcation between the two completely false? Is there or was there a middle ground? These are all kind of questions that are still ongoing among scholars, in particular in the West. Whatever the case, different forms of Sufism did exist, to the extent that a very famous historian of Islam at the University of Chicago, Marshall Hodgson, in his book, three volumes, I think it is, The Venture of Islam, he calls Sufism a mass institutionalized religion, okay, in the Islamic heartlands in the 12th and 13th century. In effect, what he's saying is that Sufism was normative Islam. It's absolutely huge. All you have to do, in fact, is, for example, read the travels of the Moroccan traveler Ibn Battuta, you know, who travels right throughout Anatolia, travels through northern Iran and beyond. You know, every single page, you know, he's staying at a khanqah, he's staying at some kind of convent, receiving some kind of initiation. You know, this is a perfect example of the kind of mass institutionalized religion that Sufism was, that Marshall Hodgson is talking about. Now, it's probable that Ibn Battuta wasn't like a genuine Sufism, a Sufi, in the respect that maybe he didn't have any kind of mystical unveiling. But nevertheless, it indicates to us that from a historical perspective, these institutions had a huge, huge social role to play. Okay. So as I've already mentioned, when we come to the 12th and 13th century, the role of, in particular, the role of Ali becomes much, much more pronounced within the Sufi tradition. It's notable too, in particular, within the movement known as Fotovat or Jabhat Nadi. We have these associations which are mentioned by Ibn Battuta, in particular in Anatolia. He mentions the word of the Ohis, okay, which is the Anatolian equivalent of a Jabal Mad. It's quite interesting, in fact, that Ibn Battuta mentions these Ohis or these Jabal Mads time and time again in Anatolia. But when he comes to Khorasan, nothing. However, what is interesting is that there are other authors, such as Hafez Arbaru, who talks about the Sarbadaz, the organization in Khorasan, and he also mentions these were dervishes and ahis who also had a profession. So it does seem to be the case that this kind of movement was widespread throughout Anatolia and Iran. But what's interesting about these groups of young men, for want of a better term, is that they all trace their lineage back to Ali. If you look at the manuals which were written in the 13th and 14th century, there's increasing, if you like, veneration of Ali. That's not to say that they were Shia. Certainly not to say that they were Shia. There's no mention, for example, of Kerbala, of Imam Hussein. It does seem to be focused upon Ali. However, what is important, I think, and the case that might be made, is that this tendency to foreground the role of Ali makes what happened in the 16th century under the Safavids that much more easier to comprehend. if you like, the Futuhat organizations paved the way in Iran for the gradual establishment of Shia Islam in Iran. So there we have a picture of Imam Ali with his famous sword, and obviously the Shia symbolizing Ali himself. So turning now back to the Qalandar Sufis. Who were the Qalandars? Well, basically, it's a bit of an enigma in many ways, because we find that the term Qalandar existed in Persian literature long before the actual social manifestation of the movement itself. So, for example, you can find these words associated with the Qalandar in the poetry of people like Sana'i and in the works of Ansari. Okay? But it's only much later that we have the actual evidence, if you like, the manuscript evidence, the literary evidence of social movements, of specific individuals who can be known as Qalandars. And this occurs in the 13th century. So two of the founding figures are these individuals by the name of Jamal ad-Din Sori and Qutb ad-Din Haydar. Okay, if you're interested, you can find a very useful book about the development of the Qalandars by a Turkish scholar called Ahmad Kar Mustafa, a book called, I think, Divan Dervishes or something like this. Anyway, what's interesting about Jamal ad-Din Sari and Qutb ad-Din Haydar is that they have a lot in common. They both lived away from society. One lived in graveyards, another lived on a mountainside, and they both had very, very unconventional forms of grooming their hair. Okay, and this becomes apparent in later Sufi history. For these two founding figures, it seems to be the case that they actually grew their hair, or they grew their beards and moustaches, but in a fashion that was in contrast to the established practices of Muslims at that time. Okay. The other thing to notice about these two is that there is a distinct aversion to clothing. And so perhaps this is understandable because they lived in remote places. They didn't feel the need to be bound over to society, in which case they'd have to be careful about how they appeared in society. But nevertheless, they attracted some kind of following, some kind of group of disciples were attracted around them, and so therefore they were forced, if you like, to cover up and behave perhaps what we might consider to be in a more normal fashion. And that explains why they were more or less obliged to come away from the mountainside, come away from the graveyard, and establish what can only be called as a khanagah or a tekiyah, and teach their Sufi-esque kind of devotions and ascetic practices. The hair of the Qalandars becomes, I think, particularly relevant because in a later period, it became normative for Qalandar Sufis to appear with what is known in Persian as the chahar zarb. That is, they would shave their head completely, but not only that, they would shave their moustache, their beard, and their eyebrows. Now, this is completely shocking, not just in, let's say, medieval Islamic society, but also within Sufi groups themselves. It's often said that Sufis are they're deviant people, they don't care about sharia and these kind of things, but that's not true. If you read the works of all the major masters of Sufism, there's a distinct emphasis, if you like, on obeying the sharia. If you obey the sharia, then you can follow the tariqah and then develop onto the haqiqah. Okay? So in effect, the Qalandars were very specific forms of Sufis, if you like, and they were distinct partly because of their manifestation of their grooming, their hair. That is, you know, the hair on the head, the moustache, their beard, and their eyebrows. So this is an image, but unfortunately this Qalandar Sufi has eyebrows. So maybe his razor became a bit blunt before he got there. So, turning now to the Safavids, what happened? I'm sure many of you will know that the Safavids emerged from a Sufi order themselves, based in Azerbaijan. Okay. And when the Safavids came to power, they more or less declared from year one that Shia Islam would be the religion of what became the dynasty. So this stood them in contrast to their immediate neighbours, obviously the Ottomans. Problems that they faced, however, is that the majority of the population in Iran was Sunni. Fortunately, they had allies. There were some people who were Shia, including groups of Qalandars. The problem, however, is what to do with the other Sufi orders. As I mentioned before, there were groups of Naqshbandis, groups of Mehrevis, and so on and so forth, who were Sunni. So what was the problem? What were the Safavids going to do with these groups? In addition to the denominational conflict, an additional issue is that according to traditional forms of Sufi thinking, the Sufi aspirant or the dervish would offer his ultimate allegiance to the Sufi peer or the sheikh. Now this must have seemed to the Shah of Iran as a conflict of interest in the respect that the Sufis gave their allegiance to the sheikh, whereas he was looking to get their ultimate allegiance himself. So that's another reason, perhaps, that we can say that the Safavids had this kind of desire to establish a community in which the Shah or the monarch received ultimate veneration, if you like. There's a nice image, if you like, of the mausoleum of Sheikh Safiuddin, founder of the Safavid order, died in 1334. So, it's generally accepted among scholars that there are two waves of anti-Sufi sentiment emanating from perhaps a combination of forces which centralized around the monarch and also certain clerical figures. So the first wave of repression against Sufism was against the Gizlbash. Gizlbash, of course, were the traditional Turkish tribespeople who had supported the original movement of the Safavids. Why did the Shah move against the Gizlbash? Well, basically, we have this idea that they're potentially a threat. Who do the Gizlbash actually owe their allegiance to? The Gizlbash were also great proponents and very fond of this piece of work known as the Abu Muslim Name. Abu Muslim, of course, was involved in the Abbasid Revolution, and it ties in with the ideas of millenarianism that spread around Iran in the 14th and 15th century. So the Shah, if you like, could never rest safely in his bed at night, knowing that there was a potential threat to him from the Gizlbash. And likewise, at the same time, in this first wave, if you like, of repression, there is a movement against various Sufi orders, established Sufi orders, established in the sense that they have their khanagars, they're perhaps in urban areas. The Shah knows where they are. Okay? So, as an example, you know, there's this famous massacre which was perpetrated by Shah Abbas against the Sufis, the Gizlbash, in Lahijan in 1614 to 1615. I mentioned just now that, you know, around this time there were still these ideas of millenarianism in Iran, which I guess sprang out of these, if you like, these Harufi movements in the 14th century and again emanated in the Safavid period, so that we have this Nuqtawi movement, which was associated by some people with Qalandars simply because there were certain individuals with Qalandar sounding names. Okay, when we look at the histories which were written in the Safavid period, we do get names of certain Qalandars. Whether this is factual history or not is difficult to verify, but certainly, you know, they're there, they're historical manuscripts which we can point to and say, well, it needs certain, it needs to be taken with a certain degree of skepticism, if you like, but there's a clue in there somewhere, okay? The second wave of Sufi repression was different in the respect that it was directed more towards the Irfani supporters of Sufism, okay? Irfan still posed a problem for certain clerics of Shi'a Islam simply because of the nature of Irfani beliefs. In the respect that Irfan postulates that it's possible that God in some fashion can be experienced and known. Not just experienced and known in the afterlife, but right here and now. And that was a huge, huge problem for some of these the clerics, okay? In addition to that, if one does hold certain Irfani beliefs, there's a logical progression from there to talk about how one actually achieves that knowledge and experience of God. The knowledge and experience of God was achieved, it was held by some, through specific Sufi practices, including so-called raqsidan, or dancing, Sufi style, listening to Persian poetry, listening to the Quran, listening to devotional praises to God, and so on and so forth. The danger for the clerics was that this could lead to over-ecstatic expressions, emotionalism, which is not conducive to, if you like, public morality, okay? So we have a number of tracts which were written by clerics in the 16th and 17th century, widely condemning not just popular Sufism, but also the more intellectualized form of Irfan. So I've given you an example of such a cleric. There's a guy, a cleric by the name of Mullah Muhammad Tahir Qomi, who has a book entitled Al-Fawa'id al-Diniyah fi Rad al-Hukuma wal-Sufiyah. There are many, many more. I think I've got some examples. Yeah, cleric by the name of Limatullah al-Jazairi, and his worldview in relation to Sufism has been paraphrased by a scholar whose name eludes me right now, but she says that al-Jazairi likened the world to a human organism and compared the king to a man's head and the ulama to his heart. In this order, the Qalandars were analogous to a man's pubic and armpit hair because they have no function in the body. It is harmful and must be plucked out in the same way as the Qalandar needs to be uprooted from society. So here we have not only scholars rejecting Irfani Sufism, but we also have clerics rejecting the more popular forms of Sufism which they associated with the Qalandars. Even those scholars who may be considered among the Irfani scholars were also critical of forms of popular Sufism, such as the Qalandar. So we can point to Mullah Sadra in his Kasra Asnam. He talks about smashing the idols of ignorance in condemnation of the Sufi pretenders, in other words, the Qalandar. Okay? So here we have another image of the kind of received kind of perspective that we have of the Qalandars in Safavid Iran. Notice the bald hair, the sheepskin coat, and more or less the rags around his body. However, now we come to the reassessment. Are the Qalandars really, or were they really, really as bad as some of the texts make them out to be? Did the Qalandars actually have a positive role to play in Safavid society? Well, firstly, we can point to the fact that there was a certain degree of synergy between the Qalandars and the monarchs of Safavid Iran. in the respect that they both endorse and try to popularize Shia Islam. In particular, we have this tradition of cursing Sunnis. Okay? We have the example of Shah Tahmasp sending a document to the Sunni Ottoman Caliph, noting that he had ordered a group known as the Ritual Disavows and also the Qalandars to chant curses at the Sunnis, which of course included the Ottoman Caliph. We have a text written by Shustari, who died in 610, so obviously he's right in the middle of the Safavid period, and he mentions the followers of a certain Qutb al-Din Haydar Tuni, who died in 1427, who is considered as one of the forefathers of Iran's Qalandars. Indeed, he's mentioned in the treatise that I'm going to talk about in due course. And apparently this individual whispered curses that were directed at Sunnis into the ears of his dervishes, his novices, his initiates. Okay. What's also interesting, this idea of ritually cursing bleeds into the idea that we get from the European travel writers of the time. People like Chardin, people like Sanson. Okay, and they mention the fact that there were certain Sufis who used to travel around, not travel around, but walk around the streets. They would be in coffee houses and they would recite certain things and they would preach. The problem with these texts from the European travel writers is that they do not specify the kind of Sufis they're talking about. So we can only speculate that these might have been Qalandar Sufis. Qalandar Sufis who frequented street corners, started to pray, started to address people, ask for alms, and started to preach in and around the coffee houses, which became popular in Iran at the time. Secondly, can we say that the Qalandars were also part of the process that enabled Iran to expand and enabled the Safavids to establish power over the whole of the territory? Certainly, I believe it does seem to be the case that there's a movement away from traditional forms of Qalandar activity. Now, traditionally, Qalandars have been understood as mendicants. That is to say, they travelled around, they had no fixed abode, they were beggars, so on and so forth. I mean, prime example is someone like Fakhruddin Iraqi. There is evidence, however, that by a later stage, the Qalandars have their own khanagahs or tekiyas. So there must have been some degree of, if you like, sedentary activity. They were fixed for a specific certain amount of time, if you like. Okay, it makes no sense just to think of Qalandar Sufis going from one place to another place and having no fixed abode. We also have to bear in mind, I think, that at this time, at the beginning of the 16th century, the Safavid economy is booming. There's a mass expansion of building in Isfahan. If there's a mass expansion of building in Isfahan, who's doing the building? Who's providing the ancillary labour? Can we speculate that part of this workforce was composed of Sufis and Qalandars? It seems to make logic to me that it's perfectly possible that this indeed was the case. In addition to that, there does seem to be evidence of a link between certain Qalandar rituals and certain forms of trade activities. When you look back at Qalandar manuals, way, way back, as far as you possibly can, into maybe the 12th, 13th, 14th century, there's a distinct correlation between the content style of these treatises with the same kind of Qalandar manuals and treatises which emerge in the 15th, 16th, and 17th century. In particular, there is an emphasis on the tools of the barber. Now, what's the link here? What's going on? Remember the Chahar-Zarb? The four shaves need these kind of implements, scissors, the whetstone to sharpen the razor. Okay? It's possible that these were the implements that the barbers used. The kind of references that you get to these tools of the trade are found right across the centuries in Qalandar works. We have to be careful too when we talk about Qalandar works, because it's often the case that the treatises do not always mention Qalandars. They're just almost, if you like, anonymized works without titles, without the name of the author. But from the contents and the similarity of style, you can see there's a distinct similarity between the works that we do know are Qalandar works and these other works which are perhaps more associated with the trade of the barbers. What I'm speculating, and what others in Iran have also speculated, there's a very well-known scholar by the name of Mehran Ashari, who's discussed this before, is that the Qalandars and the barbers are intimately linked, to the extent that it might be the case that the Qalandar lifestyle also involved certain periods in which they were settled and engaged in this function, a trade. We also have to be aware that the task of the barber was not simply to cut hair. The barber was also employed in the hammams. He was also employed to pull teeth, draw blood. So in fact, the functions or the trades that the Qalandars or the barbers were engaged in were much more inclusive than, let's say, modern barbers today. Okay, so what I'm suggesting is that the influence that the Qalandars had in society was quite pervasive in many different spheres of activity. Well, I think I've covered most of that. The other thing that's quite interesting, and this is perhaps even more speculative, I'm not sure that I fully accept what I've written here, but there may be links between the Qalandars and the Haydaris. The Haydaris, of course, were groups of individuals who were associated with certain wards, mahalle in Persian, okay, which functioned at the time of Safavid Iran as a way in which the Shah was able to control society, because you have, of course, a great rivalry, if you like, between the Haydaris and the Matalahis. Now, remember, we also have this linkage with Qutbuddin Haydar. And some historians, like Abdul Hussein Zarin Kub, have made this connection between the Qalandars and the Haydaris. So can we say that in addition just to being barbers in society, Qalandars in some way were linked with the establishment of these, if you like, these mahalles in urban areas? This is a possibility which I struggle with. I don't think the evidence is conclusive, but I think it's perhaps an area in which more research could be very, very rewarding. So, the problem we face when we study the Qalandars in the Safavid period concerns our sources. Qalandars, by their nature, are often typified as low class, badly educated, and as a result, we do not really have an extensive body of emic literature. There's not many sources that were written by Qalandars. However, we have one very, very interesting source which was published in Tehran about 20 years ago under the title of Ayin-e Qalandari. In this book, there are four main treatises, one of which was this one here. It doesn't have a title. We do not know the name of the author. Okay, but the contents are extremely interesting and support the idea that the Qalandars in some ways shouldn't be considered as, you know, these emotional, ecstatic Sufis who are fornicating everywhere on the streets, which was the idea of like these Russian travelers in the 16th century. We get the idea that these Qalandars were law-abiding, following the Sharia, and endorsing and advocating Shia Islam. In effect, what this treatise does is more or less contribute to the argument that we can understand Safavid society and what the monarchs were trying to do as build constituencies. That is to say, so long as the Qalandar were law-abiding, okay, and embraced the right of the Shah to be the monarch of Iran, then they would not be persecuted. Okay. What I've done, I've broken down this treatise into a series of chapters. These chapters, it's difficult actually to locate them within the text, but certainly within the text itself, there do seem to be natural breaks. Sometimes they are evident with the title Bab, other times it's not really apparent at all, apart from the introduction of Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Okay? But I think this division is fairly secure in the respect that each of the divisions looks at something different. So what I'm trying to say is that there's not much repetition. If there had been repetition in these divisions that I've given you, it could be the case that what's going on is that we have a series of authors writing small treatises and they've all just been bundled together. But it does seem to me that the text has a kind of coherence, a logic, and it indicates that the author or authors knew what they were doing and they were writing to a premeditated plan. So in the first section, you can see that basically there's a mention of the word Suleiman. Okay, there's a quote from the Quran, which gives us an indication that the authors are paying their allegiance, whether it's just lip service or not, it doesn't matter, but they're paying allegiance to the monarch. They're declaring their own obedience to the Safavid monarchy, okay? In the second division, you get a kind of quite simplistic and standard stratification, if you like, of Islam into Islam, Iman, Ihsan. And this kind of threefold division of Islam is reflected in the idea of the Shariat, Tariqat, and Hadiyat. It's not hard to comprehend. So perhaps we're looking at the authors targeting a certain audience. That is to say, they're not concerned with Irfani Sufis. They're more concerned perhaps with people who are engaged in other forms of activity. Maybe they're working. Maybe they're involved in trade. Maybe they are the barbers. In the third division, we get something quite interesting. We get a linkage between what's going on here in terms of, if you like, the courtesies, the adab, with the ideas of fotovat. I've argued before in other publications that the development of fotovat from the 13th century reflects a kind of second-class Sufism. Second-class Sufism in the respect that these were individuals who wanted to benefit from the, if you like, the charisma of the sheikh, the charisma of the Sufi order, without paying 100% of their devotions and time to the Sufi movement. In effect, the Futuva organizations were for the masses, the tradespeople. And this links in with the idea that maybe the Qalandars, again, were urbanized, sedentary individuals who were working. It's also interesting that these Fotovat treatises, which emerged from the 13th century, pay specific attention to Ali, okay? And within the section, within the third section, there is this constant references to Ali, and he's also linked with the kind of rituals, the initiations that the people of Futuwa are involved in, such as the girding with the shad, okay, which was a typical kind of garment that the Jabal Madan or the Ahl Futuwat would wear rather than the Sufi cloak. I notice that there's, within this third section, there's a specific chapter within the chapter, which is known as the Futuwat Nami Amir al-Mu'minin. Okay, so if we want any further evidence of the central role of Ali, there it is. The fourth section is interesting because it discusses specific Qalandar rituals, such as the shaving and the kind of implements used in the ritual activity, which we mentioned before, the scissors and the whetstone, which makes a link with the trade of the barbers. The fifth section is called the Virtues, the Fazilat Name of the Commander of the Faithful Ali. But what's interesting here too is that in this section we have a list, a simple list, of the different kinds of Shia Islam. Why? What's going on? Why did the authors include these simplistic lists of different kinds of Shia Islam? It kind of resonates, if you like, with the ideas and writings of the European travel writers such as Chardin and Sanson that we mentioned earlier. These Sufis who would go around, stand on street corners, go to the coffee houses and preach. What were they preaching? Is it the case that even at this time, after 150 years, if you like, of Shia indoctrination by the Safavids, is it the case that there was still a need for certain individuals, Qalandars, to propagate the true form of Shia Islam? Or is it the case that the Qalandars were instrumental in propagating 12 Shia Islam to perhaps the young in society rather than those who were already educated? Okay, of course we don't know the total truth, we can only speculate on these kind of possibilities, but you know, it does make you really wonder why we have these lists of the Zaydi Imams, of the Ismaili Imams, and then 12 Shia Imams. What's also interesting in general about this text is that it is littered with hadith. It's also interesting too that at this time we have the emergence in Iran among Shia scholars of a deep interest in hadith, typified by Majlisi, whose Bihar al-Anwar at this time becomes quite a major work. And Majlisi of course included all kinds of traditions, all kinds of hadith which hadn't been used by other Shia scholars before for centuries. And likewise in this Qalandar Name, okay, we have, for example, the use of the hadith, he who knows his Lord knows himself, which is a hadith which is problematic for many scholars anyway, despite the fact that in this treatise it's attributed to Ali. Okay? But again, it's an indication that the Qalandars are trying to say something. And what they're trying to say for me is that, look, we are good Shias, we're contributing to this, the kind of like constitution of the Safavid state, leave us alone, we are supporting you. The sixth chapter, explaining the gates of the Qalandariya, describes a specific form of clothing worn by the Qalandars. Again, it's a link to the barbers because they wore something known as the tanura, or an apron, if you like, and this was a kind of apron that was traditionally worn by the barbers. Okay? In the seventh section, explaining the sharia, tariqa, and haqiqa, and the obligatory commands and the conditions. Again, it's the idea that the Qalandar are not antinomian, they're not anti sharia. They're perfectly content to abide by the Sharia law in Safavid Iran and engage in society. Okay? At the same time, there is mention of specific Qalandar themes. Again, there's clothing mentioned. There's the targe, the crown that they would wear. And what's also interesting is that we have a linkage with the Qalandar and particular ritual activities such as giving water, sagai, which of course is so, so important in Shi'a Islam, especially around the time of Muharram. The last chapter is a chapter which perhaps is the biggest problem, because it does seem to be composed largely of bits of poetry which have been taken from here, there and everywhere. And again, one wonders if these were the kinds of things that maybe Shardan and Sansom heard again on the street corners. But again, in these kind of in this kind of poetry, you can see the kind of way that it fed into the Shia devotions of the time, you know, with the mention of the family and the children of Mustafa, our love. So, in short, a clear attempt has been made to present different elements of the Qalandar path. They range from allegiance to 12 Shi'ism, ritual performance, ethical perfection, and mythical history. Mythical history in the respect that within this Qalandar Name, there's like a selsele going right back to foundational and formative figures in the history of Islam, such as Salman Farsi. And of course, the name Salman Farsi should immediately alert you to this connection with the Babers. Okay? It's interesting that you have these ideas of the selsele and the initiation that takes place between each link. At the initiation, what is the initiation? It's the shaving. Again, another link with the Babers. So what can we conclude from all of this? Aside from just being of interest to the development of Sufi history in Iran, I think it's quite interesting too because of what it says about the nature of power in Safavid Iran, in the respect that what the Safavid Shahs were actually attempting to do was not so much denigrate Sufism, it was an attempt by them to preserve their own position, their own power, and to create these constitutions, support whoever was prepared to endorse them. This seems to be the case with this Qalandar Name. The fact that it was written at a time when Sufism was still under threat from major clerical figures, yet the Shah was not prepared to endorse a wholesale purge, if you like, of the Qalandars, as many Shahs had done against other Sufi orders. Okay, the Qalandars were Shia, they were becoming useful in society, they were cursing the Sunni caliphs, they were teaching perhaps the young and the uneducated on the streets, they were giving their allegiance to the Shah, they were getting involved in the economy, they were barbers, they were building. So there's a whole lot that we can speculate by looking at these kind of texts, which unfortunately are very, very few in number. But I think careful study of them, with a little bit of maybe creative thinking, I hope it's not been too creative, but with a bit of creative thinking, we can perhaps speculate. Maybe these received ideas about the Safavid monarchs being inherently anti-Sufi need to be rethought just a little bit. So on there, I'll conclude, and I'm more than happy to answer any questions that you may have.